are so fortunate this morning. Thank you, Tim. Tim Edwards comes to us by way of Detroit, Michigan. He's performed many roles in several orchestras, from section performer to principal performer to concertmaster at the Flint Symphony, the Toledo Symphony, and of course with our very own Jacksonville Symphony, among others. While his focus is primarily on classical music, he has performed with notable artists such as Al Jarreau, Aretha Franklin, and Mariah Carey. He has served as an adjunct professor at Florida State College at Jacksonville, as a faculty member at Jacksonville University, and currently enjoys his teaching studio. We are so privileged to have him with us today. Thank you. I'd like to invite Ted Clisby, please, to light our chalice this morning. Our words are by Catherine Esty. Little flame, light the tender kindling of our souls, and soon a roaring blaze shall be of warmth and love and community. From this little spark, may a fire of passion spread from heart to heart and light our way, sweet spirit, and light our way. I would like to invite you to please remain seated as we share in reading our congregational covenant, which is printed inside your order of service. We'll read it together. We covenant to engage one another with honesty, kindness, and respect, to value diversity, seek understanding of our differences, and practice gracious accountability with care, love, and empathy. We make these promises to those who are here and those yet to come, so that we may be a safe, welcoming, and beloved community of acceptance, learning, and transformation. And now please rise in body or spirit as we sing our call to worship. The words are printed on the front of your order of service. This morning's opening words are by Orlando B. Brugnola. Here find a house of welcoming. Here find vision and hope. Here be received as you truly are, unique and beautiful. Your journey acknowledged, your love honored. Let us rejoice together. Good morning, friends, and welcome to this special time we have to spend together today. My name is Caitlin Regan, and my pronouns are she and her. I am a woman. I am a wife. I am a mother. I am a worker. I am a singer. And I live with mental illness. I am unique. And like all of you here, and those of all of us not here, I belong. We all belong on the many roads we walk, because as Unitarian Universalists, we make it so. Today and every day, we bring our core selves to the universe, knowing and not knowing whether we are welcome. In this space, we open our hearts wide to the possibility that comes from both shared and unshared experience. For those experiences still unshared, we open our hearts wider still to welcome all the wonder that lives outside ourselves. We all bring our gifts and all belong here to each other and to the universe. Welcome to this special place today and always. I would like to extend a special welcome to anyone who is visiting us for the first time this morning. We are so glad you're here. We hope you'll take some time to learn more about us by visiting our welcome table or mingling with our members on the back patio, straight back through that door, after the service. We will be serving light refreshments, and you can learn more about Unitarian Universalism, our church, and our welcoming congregation. If you've been coming a while and are interested in becoming a member, we offer new member classes regularly. You can speak to anyone with a new Ask Me sticker on their name tag for detailed information, and we thank you so much for joining us today. Our faith is based on universal love, hope, justice, and joy for all people. We share the understanding that everyone belongs, and we breathe life into that understanding through meaningful action. None of us is perfect, and we accept that as we continually learn and then adjust as we go. It is in that spirit that I welcome you to not only sit together this morning, but to worship together, to learn together, and to grow together. I am grateful for each and every one of you. And now I will welcome you to please rise in body or spirit as we sing hymn number 318, We Would Be One. We will sing all the verses.
Let's light a flame of celebration for our Labor Day tomorrow to honor all who work. We are grateful for all the labors that support our world. May rough, worn hands and aching backs be healed. May those who labor to survive live to know justice. Let's all lift up those who provide the unpaid labor of homemaking, childcare, elder care, and differently abled care that isn't a part of our economic system. Our society would collapse without it. There is also the work done to educate, assist, advocate, entertain, and enrich our world. Honor your labor. If you work for money, the holiday is for you. If you work for love, this holiday is still for you. Our work makes this world better. Celebrate your day and celebrate yourself tomorrow.
Thank you so very much, Tim. A religious community is like a river formed from the many streams of our lives that meet and merge and flow to the sea. As members and friends of this religious community, we share our time and energy, our creativity, imagination, and vision, our talents, skills, and gifts, and the streams of our individual lives create a river that is both deep and broad, a river that is made of many streams, sustains life, and refreshes the land through which it flows. But the river of this community also depends on our shared financial support that makes real our shared values and vision. We will now receive an offering for the support of this religious community and its work in the world. You are invited to give generously and joyfully as you are willing and able, after which we will rise in body or spirit to sing hymn number 123, Spirit of Life. And I would like to invite Judy and Peter Olevnik forward to help pass the plates this morning. Reverend Christine Dance is the minister of the Unitarian Universalist Congregation of Phoenix, Arizona. Before moving to Phoenix, she spent 20 years in Orlando, serving as a lay leader from everything from the worship committee to stewardship to managing a large renovation project to singing in the choir. She was ordained by the First Unitarian Church of Orlando. And prior to ministry, Christine had a 30-year career in marketing, communications, product development, and innovation, including a time working as Pokemon brand manager for Hasbro Toys in the late 90s. Christine and her wife, Karen, have two grown sons, four cats, two dogs, and they love camping, hiking, working on their home, entertaining, and traveling. We are blessed to have Reverend Christine here in our virtual pulpit this morning.
Hello, Buckman Bridge Unitarian Universalists. I am the Reverend Christine Dance, and I am honored to be back with you this morning. And I'm absolutely delighted by the relationship that we've developed over technology since the pandemic. I am sending you all my very good energy to you personally and to your entire congregation and the wonderful community that you are. So, have any of you ever heard of preppers? No, I'm not talking about preppy, that really regrettable trend from the 80s. I'm talking about preppers. They're people who go to extreme measures to prepare for emergencies. Not like emergencies like a strong storm or a heart attack. No, they're preparing for the end of the world, like a nuclear war, or a takeover of our social or political order, or a zombie apocalypse. So I'm just fascinated by them. I used to watch this TV show called Doomsday Preppers. It was on National Geographic, and it would feature folks who would spend tens of thousands or more of dollars preparing their home or building entirely new homes underground, stockpiling food and weapons. They are preparing, hence the name preppers. One of the shows had a family that built an entirely separate house out of shipping containers. They stockpiled enough food to last their family of four for 20 years. They had weapons to protect themselves from people who would come and try to take away their food. And they said it wasn't a just-in-case thing. It was a lifestyle. They spent much of their time preparing for this apocalypse, and they saw it as not only possible, but probable. There are times that I think I should have gone into sociology because I find this all fascinating. Like, I really wonder how their minds work and how they thought of this and what their ideologies are that make them think that this is the most responsible or reasonable response to our world. But then, honestly, I think this is probably true about for any of us who have watched any kind of reality show. I step back and see if I could see myself in that position. And honestly, the answer is no. Not because I don't believe in the apocalypse, which I don't, by the way, but because I can't imagine myself living in a shipping container for 20 years. And I love my family, truly. But I don't know that I want to spend the next 20 years in 100 square feet with just them. I think I would probably rather be taken out by the apocalypse. I would be alive if I lived, but what is really the point of existing in that? To me, living without other people, being in community, growing and exploring and changing is what gives me life. In the end, I want to feel like I belong to something bigger than myself. I think that one of the byproducts of our postmodern culture is our deep hunger to belong. And I feel like the pandemic has only accelerated and amplified that. There is irony around belonging and technology because in theory, we are more connected to each other by technology than ever before, by social media and texting and Zoom. Essentially, I have a way to type anything to anyone or call and see them all in a little device that I hold in my pocket. But despite all of this, more and more people are feeling isolated and marginalized. Instead of that technology uniting us, it gives us a simulated sense of belonging that leaves us somehow feeling hollow and disconnected. We certainly learned the benefits of technology the last couple years, but oh boy, did we also learn the limitations of it as well. Consumerism and our Western ideals of individualism just fuels this. By wanting more and more, we isolate ourselves. Individualism tells us that we are mountains unto ourselves. And by the time we realize that this is a lie, we find ourselves even further isolated and lonely. John O'Donohue, in his book, External Echoes, Exploring Our Yearning to Belong, says that our global village has no roads or neighbors. It is a faceless limbo. He says that we are in the midst of a huge crisis of belonging. Now, I also, the sociologist part in me, loves hearing the stories about how folks find Unitarian Universalism. I'm wondering how many of you know how each other at Buckman Bridge found this congregation and Unitarian Universalism overall. I know that some folks found UUs after 9/11, needing a way to be together after a tragedy and the complex challenges following it. Many people came to Unitarian Universalism as part of what is called the Trump bump, a term for people who decided to become UUs after Trump got elected. It's a phenomenon that happened around UU congregations around the country, very much happened in my congregation here in Phoenix. Again, that inner sociologist, why, if you're looking for this, why a religious organization? You could have volunteered at a political party or an activist group, or just put a lot of bumper stickers on your car. Why join a Unitarian Universalist congregation? I think belonging is at the core. When it felt like we didn't know our country anymore, people wanted to find a place where they felt like they belonged, where their worldview, and note that I'm not necessarily saying their political view, matched others, and they could feel a sense of connectedness and togetherness. From the time that we are born, we yearn to belong. We look for where we fit in, where we feel safe, and where we can be our full selves. We come to our UU church because we are craving the same thing. And yet I know that there are many of you out there who still might not feel like you belong. It might be because you don't know a lot of people, and there's still a sense of isolation, even among so many people there and online or in your sanctuary. It might be that you are feeling disconnected after the pandemic, from your church, from your family, from so many other things. It may be because you don't feel like there is space for someone with your particular situation or circumstance. It may be because you have experienced hurt or betrayal or confusion or a sense that you are not needed. Or it could be because you've had so much isolation and hurt in the outside world that you're still trying to navigate what belonging feels like in this environment. Parker Palmer says that spirituality refers to the eternal human longing to be part of something larger than one's own ego. We want to belong to something larger than ourselves. It is our nature to be in this human mess together and to know that at a deep level that we belong. Despite our individualistic culture, we yearn for that deep sense of connection. Unconnected, we're just preppers in a shipping container, existing with food and water, and fighting off anyone who infringes on our territory. Connected, however, we are more human. We are more than ourselves alone. And I believe that we can get that sense of belonging in an environment of worship better than we can in other societal gathering places. Especially in Unitarian Universalism, we are working to build the community here that we wish to see in the wider world. We are intentionally looking at our structures, our behaviors, our culture, and doing the work to make it more inclusive, creating the wider circle of who is welcome into it. Together, we are following that deep drive to imagine that larger web of belonging. But belonging doesn't just happen. You don't just show up somewhere and poof, you belong. Belonging often depends on making connections, knowing people who know some of your story or share a common experience. I know that when I started coming to a UU church, I was a lurker for several years. I actually didn't want to belong. I just wanted to escape for an hour each week, and that was perfectly fine for me. But once that feeling of escape was filled, I yearned for something more. So I got involved. I know that for myself and probably many of you, my sense of belonging was very tightly tied to my UU congregation. My friends, my sense of contribution, and a deep connection to shared commitment was shared with these other people who I really liked. Some of you may still be in the escape mode, and that's just fine. Do it as long as you need. But if you are looking to belong, I encourage you to join something. Be part of something than just attending worship. I promise you that it will enhance your sense of belonging. Belonging sometimes means looking at systems of oppression. It is easy for those who are our culture's dominant groups to say that we are open and welcoming and anyone can belong. But sometimes, even when we are unaware, we are sending the opposite message. When we point out people's differences or treat them differently for any reason, we are sending the message that they don't belong with us. We need to individually educate ourselves and be aware of different perspectives so that we are not excluding anyone from belonging here. And belonging sometimes requires a risk of vulnerability. Sometimes it means asking for help, or sharing a difficult story, or making a mistake, sometimes a big one. In my congregation, we talk about humaning with each other, that we are humans doing the act of humaning with each other. We have the expectation that we will make mistakes, and we strive to be vulnerable with each other. And every time we are humaning, we are risk making those mistakes, needing to apologize, and coming back into community again. I believe that each time we are affirmed in our ability to be fully human, our belonging cup is filled a little bit more. Douglas Steer says, the ancient question, who am I, inevitably leads to a deeper one, whose am I? Because there is not identity outside of relationship. You cannot be a person by yourself. To ask, whose am I, is to extend the question far beyond the little self-absorbed self and to wonder, to whom do I belong? It means asking who needs you, who cares for you, who is affected by your choices, whose life is bound up with yours. I yearn for each one of you to say, I belong here at Buckman Bridge Unitarian Universalist Church. I feel like I am home here. I feel like I can speak my mind, my stretch, my spirit, and let my soul soar here. I yearn to say that you belong here. I hope that that extends to you and to everyone who you come in contact with it. And knowing that deep down in your heart, that you feel like you belong. So might it be in your church and in our greater world. Many blessings to you.
And now, please rise in body or spirit to join me in singing hymn number 323, Break Not the Circle. And we will again sing all of the verses.
Thank you.
if Ted could please come up and extinguish our chalice. Reverend Christine mentioned John O'Donohue, and he wrote this morning's benediction. May you listen to your longing to be free. May the frames of your belonging be generous enough for your dreams. May you arise each day with a voice of blessing whispering in your heart. May you find a harmony between your soul and your life. May the sanctuary of your soul never become haunted. May you know the eternal longing that lives at the heart of time. May there be kindness in your gaze when you look within. May you never place walls between the light and yourself. May you allow the wild beauty of the invisible world to gather you, mind you, and embrace you in belonging. Amen.